And it's difficult to believe that today businesses are run 100% with one's own money. Own money plays an important part. I'm not denying that. But without at least some help from the bank, or without at least the bank coming in to give you working capital, even if you didn't need term loan, there was the interface with bank somewhere. Even if it was not for taking curves, it was for facilitating the business. So this approach of thinking that we wanted to pay the money lender is totally unacceptable. Whoever is giving that twist, good luck be with them. Mindsets will have to be for government, which is dealing with public money. I have to have an approach through an institutional mechanism. And therefore, we have chosen to go through this.
But would it have been wrong to give a one-time stimulus, cash in hand, money in the bank, to everybody across, like America has done, Singapore has done? Would it have been wrong?
When you compare countries like that, the comparison has to be for few other things also before suggesting a measure like this. Do we actually have proper data? Do we have proper instrumentality through which I can give that lump sum cash? Do I have?
What is the data that you require?
No, actually, if I have to, as you suggested, I have to give it across for everybody. Mm-hmm. Under various categories, I have to approach them. Because you've said across everybody. Across is what? 130 crore population.
Well, it would mean families, right?
Families, I'm giving cash.
Anybody who has
an
Aadhaar card, anybody who has a ration card, anybody who has a voter ID card, you know approximately who are the people.
With all the overlaps, even if I use all of them.
Is there no database?
That's exactly what I'm trying to tell you.
I see.
Look at the farmers. Now, the question also has a lot of inbuilt answer in it. Hmm. If I give it to a farmer and his family gets also some cash through the Ujjwala Jandan account holder for running the house, and then I'm also front loading the farmers 2000 rupees, then I'm also ensuring that those formerly employed can also take it out from the EPF, which is their money, no doubt, but it is normally kept in a fund. So I am trying to also ease up on that giving of cash. But cash giving, whilst it may convince us today that, oh yes, the government has been generous, it's given away money, will it have that multiplier giving impact? It's a thought that we've had. There can be a lot of people who would say, yes, it will have. Immediately they'll go out, buy things, and thereby demand will get triggered. Maybe sense in that argument. But we have considered various different suggestions which came. Also applied our mind, the Prime Minister's Economic Advisory Council, it has eminent economists in that. Niti Aayog has eminent economists. Finance Ministry has economic advisors. So all of us have worked together and thought this will be the best.
Ma'am, this also translated, this kind of questioning also happened when we saw migrants on the road. Lots of people said, why didn't the government just give them money? Why didn't, instead of saying that, okay, you can take ration, you can take, whenever you go, you'll get your food grains, which you have promised, and the cabinet approved it a short while ago. Now, the thing is that they don't have the money right now, they don't have the wherewithal to go and get the food, get the ration, cook it. They don't have that.
No, we didn't expect them to get the ration and cook it either. We didn't expect that. We didn't even assume that. But when we made arrangements for the states to have various camps in which they should stay, and the states would give them freshly cooked food, or the NGO would, or the Gurudwara would, or the anybody else would. And the state governments kept a broad understanding of where these migrants were by district, because I had engaged with district collectors. Many ministers were engaged with district collectors, each one being allocated a state to follow up. I was taking care of Andhra Pradesh and 10 districts in Tamil Nadu. So every time when I spoke with them, we needed to find out where they are, how are they, medical help reaching them, and so on. So we didn't expect them to take the dry ration and then cook it. But that was happening. But even as that was happening, and when the lockdown was extended, I think, and rightly, I can understand, and rightly so, many migrants had started feeling, what if he or she is affected by coronavirus? And that sense of worry and fear. Equally, what if my family in the village is remaining, and if they get affected, what happens? That worry and that fear. So that started growing in their minds. And when the extension was happening again, they wanted to literally, all right, it's okay, whether you give me food or not, I want to move out, I want to go to my village. Then is the planning for the trains being given. So in between, people started wondering, if nothing is going to happen, shall I walk? Which is very unfortunate. I won't blame the migrant. All of us could have together attended to it speedily, much more effectively and sooner. But there are so many people who are all got to be working together in this. And that is why I like to highlight the fact that some states came into this very quickly. Where, you know, in a scale of 1 to 10, if a state wanted about 10 trains, there were still, at that time, states which were asking for just one. I'm not blaming anybody. Everyone is handling a pandemic which they have never seen before. So there are gaps, but so we all have to, you know.
Some states were overwhelmed or deliberately allowed this?
I wouldn't know. And I'm constantly informed, and both the Rail Minister and the Home Minister have been really on their toes trying to say, tell us the point from where the train has to be given. We shall give the train. Within 3 hours of us asking you, you kindly, because you know where the migrants are in that district, let us say, a particular district and a particular train destination. In that district, the migrants were to be scheduled, brought to the railway station, and after what were due testing, they would social distance kept, honored, they would go in. What's the plan? So if wherever states have asked for it, the ministries have rushed in with trains.
Ma'am, you said you were in touch with the district collectors and other cabinet colleagues, I'm sure, in the government.
Everyone
was. Right, there was 1 month when these migrants were in camps, and DCs, magistrates, everybody knew how many are there in the camps. So the data was available as to how many were there and how many would want to go back.
No, it is not that plain and simple. The data is not available in that sense. In the sense that whoever came to the migrant camps, they had.
Yeah.
But what I'm asking for is for the states to have coordinated that data and district-wise to tell us, look, in this district, I have so many. Who would want some of them going to Bihar, some of them going to some other state, some other group going to UP, and so on. It requires a bit of preparedness at the district level. So the data being in the hands of the district collector alone is not it. Post that, they had to do some more work. And that from the center, I can't dictate because it's a state administration.
There was a month, and in that one, and everybody saw the chaos that happened in the first lockdown. You know, when people from went to that one bus stand and there was utter chaos when nobody knew whether Mr. Kejriwal has organized the buses or not, whether the buses are reaching UP or not. Everybody knew by then that migrants want to go back. From that day to the 1st of May, when the train started plying and people started walking, there was 1 month. In that 1 month, where are people supposed to look at as to who was at fault, other than the fact that nobody wanted to help
each
other?
If your effort is to find a fault with somebody, I'm sure the media is at liberty to do it. But I'm more looking at it as all of us will have to be in this.
The reason to find fault is that nobody should fall between the cracks.
That's fine. You may be right in doing that, and I'm not getting into that at all. You may find fault. You may also say, look, you can't repeat this like this. We have to handle this matter better. Absolutely, you are at your liberty to do that. But at this stage, what I'm looking at is if there is a way in which we can get in with a bit more system in handling migrants, let us say for an example, migrants, not in anticipation of a future pandemic. God forbid, we don't want one more. But even from the point of view of they being a big productive asset, they being one of the factor of production which is so crucial for India, can we be a bit more systematic about it? Can we have more data? Can we understand what skill sets are they? Where are they from? Would they be together with the family here, or would they be singly here and the family in the village? Unless at the lowest elected body's unit, which is a ward in a municipal area, which is a panchayat in a village, wherever there are migrants, I think this country can no longer just say, no, it's not my business, it's a state. No, the state say it's not my business, it's urban local body. The urban local body say it's not me, it's a cooperator. As a country, all of us will now have to have, after all, this
has
is a country
which has the exercise begun, ma'am?
Well, now let's, you know, handle because what is standing before us, and sooner we'll have to do
you've
something.
You've opened up now, and MSMEs and all have started functioning, but the problem is that the labor isn't there. So there will be again a reverse.
Yeah.
Reverse migration has happened, now a re-reverse.
Yeah.
Because those migrants would want to come back.
Come back.
They're all got cell phones. The owners of these
MSMEs. No, I have heard from some of these industries. They told me that they've asked questions from wherever the village is, asked questions about, look, is the lockdown going to be lifted next week? Are you going to commence production immediately? When should I be coming back? Such questions have been asked by in the last few days.
But the anxiety would be for them that if we come back after 2 weeks, if you again lock down, then what happens? Do I still get the salary or don't I get the salary? And they can obviously, it seems at least, that no law which the government can tell industry anymore that you have to continue paying salaries. I don't think that's working, right?
We'll have to see how best we are going to have to work out this with the companies and also with the migrants who may want to return. So there is a lot of work to be done between the center, state and also the companies.
Could the trains have begun earlier? Could bus service have started earlier?
Well, all these are for later. I would think now I'll attend to this issue.
The reason I'm asking is because criticism continues to come from Mr. Rahul Gandhi, from Priyanka Gandhi, from Chidambaram, all of them saying that it has been an insensitive government, the way that they have been almost paralyzed and not helped the migrants.
Well, okay, today in the opposition, you can always use any words that you want. And this was the government which gave PM Garib Kalyan within hours after the lockdown was brought in. And that Garib Kalyan meant that they would have food for the next 3 months then, now extended to 2 months, so that nobody goes hungry. We also thought of giving them cooking gas so that they shouldn't be running here and there for cooking, and also given them some, you know, amount to run the house with, some expenditure taken care of. Farmers were given and so on. So they can, obviously the opposition can comment, but I would in turn ask them, have those state governments where they are in power handled this matter any better? Wouldn't their attention be sent towards those governments and those states where even now their party or their alliance partners are in power? They have not flattened the curve. They have not had the migrants handled in a very exemplary way that all of us can learn from them. It's astonishing how, in a matter of this kind of a sensitivity, they are one after the other within that party, particularly the Congress party, irresponsibly talking about things in some other state. Would they care to look at states where they are in power? Would they care to look at it and assess for themselves that they've also been so indifferent and so uncaring that they have no business talking about BJP or the central government?
So would you rather that Priyanka Gandhi offer the bus service to the migrants walking from Maharashtra, because her party is, or the Congress party is in government in Maharashtra, rather than to Yogi in...
No, well, if she is really in focus about the Uttar Pradesh government, she should see why 300 trains arrived in Uttar Pradesh when not even 5 or 7 arrived in Chhattisgarh. I'm sorry, I don't want to politicize this, because migrants are Indians. And I think all of us in this extraordinary situation which has arisen because of the pandemic should concentrate and work together so that all of us help in this kind of a situation than finger pointing. But because you were furthering on that, and because you specifically took Uttar Pradesh, 300 trains as opposed to 7. I'm not saying the size of the populations are comparable, but the migrants probably are comparable. Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, the numbers may be comparable to entire UP put together. I'm not even talking about Maharashtra yet. Bombay, Mumbai has not even, you know, settled on the number. So please, this is unfair, dirty, and clearly shows the hypocrisy of the Congress.
There was also a very sharp exchange of words, maybe indirectly, between you and Mr. Chidambaram, you and Mr. Rahul Gandhi also. Mr. Chidambaram saying that it was a drama that was happening with the fiscal package, you know, that every 3 days you were coming and doing a press conference. And Mr. Rahul Gandhi, in regards to the migrant, where you said that this is not drama, what you were doing, and what was actually happening was that his was kind of a drama. Do you feel that it was unnecessary, those kind of sharp exchanges?
If Congress can call an official government of India announcing a package at a time like this, when everybody is asking for a stimulus, with the officials, if I come and announce it, I don't know who used it, A or B or C, but Congress. One said, oh, it's like a TV serial, every day she comes at 4. The other said, it's a drama. I didn't respond to any one of them. Even on the 5th day when I was announcing, I didn't respond to any one of them. But yet, because somebody did ask me, you know, on the migrant, you saw. So I had to say, I'll borrow their own words and tell. If ours, which were official press conferences coming and telling about what package government wants to give, is called drama, is called serial, stopping the migrants on their way when they're really walking, which makes all of us, you know, put our head down in worry and hurt.
Do you feel
sense
a sense of,
hurt?
Of anxiety also?
I feel sorry. What is this country up to? I mean, what is happening? You know, all that is worrying. And at that time, you go and sit and have a gupshup. And don't I have a right to comment on it? It's becoming bad taste. You said, oh, really? Thank you.
Ma'am, I'll come back to the package. How will private and public sector banks be able to incentivize the lending that is happening? Because there is a genuine fear that people have that there have been loan melas in the past where there was some kind of a cronyism at play, where a political leader in a particular area goes to the bank and says, "Mere ilake ke redi wale ko paise dena." You know, that kind of, how will you at micro level look at all this?
Well, this party and this government and Prime Minister Modi's approach has never been supportive of any cronyism anywhere. And in the last 5 years, you saw clearly nowhere anyone had a complaint about us, you know, calling or instructing us on the phone. So I don't think that's an issue. If anything, the banks are hesitant to extend loan which may go bad, for which the way in which we've designed the schemes is that we would definitely guarantee any loss that happens. In some schemes, it's 10% loss, 20% loss, and some others, it's 100% loss. So when the loss is not going to be tied to a decision which was made with genuine intent, with us pushing, saying, please give more credit, banks should not worry if that loan turns out to be a bad, if that decision which they took to extend further facility turns bad, they will be held responsible. They may not.
It's not a question of the banks being held responsible. What I'm saying is that will you be able to micromanage in this level to see that there is no corruption at the bank level?
Because no, that's exactly what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Corruption or cronyism, we don't promote. At the same time, I don't micromanage banks. They have to take genuine decisions, they will take. And I'm giving them guarantee about decisions going wrong, they not being held responsible. But of course, if at a local level, if cronyism, somebody does it, it's for the banks to say, no, we'll go in on the principle of who's the business, we'll give it to them. I've not promoted that.
You've talked about cutting non-essential expenditure. What would that entail? For example, what should we be looking out for? Like, what is it that...
No, there have been several committees in government. Expenditure Reforms Commission. Then also within the ministry, there's been looking at... Finance Commission has also been saying that you should cut down not so essential. And there are small, you know, projects from funded by the center, which by the time it reaches the ground, really doesn't get the bang for the buck. So there are many such which will have to be pruned?
Global export markets are extremely competitive. How will you incentivize these loans now to see that certain sectors, for example, automobiles or travel and tourism, which are labor intensive, how will they be competitive with their, in the global market?
Well, I think many of the industries themselves, I've just come, straight from an interaction with the CII. I've come here to talk to you. The CII and many other federations and associations of companies are looking at how businesses are going to operate. They have to really now compete globally with their strengths intact. And that's what is Prime Minister Modi's Atmanirbharta. So we will be placing a lot of strength on how companies can become strong to be able to integrate on the global value.
Disinvestment is a major part of this. In such a depressed economy globally, who do you think is going to come in and buy, whether it is Air India, whether it is Shipping Corporation, LIC, who's going to, where is it going to come in from? Is it going, and also this is going to be a one-time sale, one-time benefit.
That's okay, but then we have to see. It doesn't mean that tomorrow morning I'm going to do it in spite of the COVID. So there will be conscious, considered decisions taken on them.
Ma'am, you spoke about deficit financing in one of the interviews that you have spoken about, that you've not put it out of the sphere of thinking. Could you elaborate a little bit?
Well, at the moment, it's not a consideration. That's what I meant.
Right. Any specific reason why you think there's no need right now?
At this stage, we've not even considered it.
Ma'am, just as I conclude, I would like to know, do you feel that you come in for excessive criticism just because you're a woman finance minister?
I wouldn't know. But there is definitely a lot of criticism. I suppose every finance minister gets it. But now because stress is in the ground so much and affected people are probably a lot more. So there's a lot of criticism and I don't mind it. I have to take it.
You think it's part and parcel of the job that you hold?
Yes, especially in this kind of an environment.
Right. And anything that you look forward to, is there a specific personal goal that you have as finance minister during this pandemic?
That I'm supportive of as many people as I can.
Thank you so much for speaking with us.
Thank you very much.
All right, that was the finance minister speaking about a whole range of issues, including defending the center's 20 lakh crore economic package, as well as also talking about the migrants issue, admitting that states could have, in fact, acted sooner as far as helping out migrants are concerned. Some of those points coming in from the finance minister. This is one of the first interviews after the 20 lakh crore relief package announcement that was made for the last several days. In fact, those are the details of the finance minister's interview.